A very, very warm welcome to the viewers of the Mojo Story channel. Every day we bring you content and voices that really, really matter. And on the program today, it is my great honor, my privilege and my pleasure to introduce guests who represent how women are breaking literally every barrier and every frontier. And this time, it is the Indian Navy that has embraced one more layer of gender equality. Till such time as now, women were not deployed on warships, but that is going to change now. The Navy has announced that two naval aviators, both of them women, will be flying multi-role helicopters from destroyers, from frigates, from warships, from where they were previously restricted. Let's give you a sense of some of these wonderful pictures that we have on our screen before we introduce our guests today. You are seeing on your screen the sub-lieutenants Kumudini Tyagi and Vriti Singh, and we're going to be talking to them in just a minute from now. And as we've been seeing, this is a very, very important barrier that is being broken for women when it comes to the Navy. So let me welcome on the program here, to our program, we have Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini and Sub-Lieutenant Riti, and a very, very warm welcome to both of you. And thank you so much and many congratulations. Let me start by asking you what your feeling is at this point. I'll start with you, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini, if I may. Obviously a moment of great pride, but is there any level of apprehension as well?
Thank you very much, first of all. Yes, I'm very happy today. Not only me, entire my family, friends, my relatives, my instructors, my OICCI who has taught us, they all are happy.
And what is the primary feeling you say you have at this moment? Like if you had to use one word, Kumudini, what would it be?
A sense of responsibility.
That's wonderfully said. Sub-Lieutenant Riti, if I can ask you to add to that, because I know that women for a long time have been wanted to be deployed on warships and it's finally happened. First, may I, because I'm so much older than you, may I ask both of you your ages? I just want the country to know how young and brave you are. How old are both of you?
I am 24. I am 25.
So very, very young, in your 20s. Sub-Lieutenant Riti, tell us your primary feeling at the moment.
At the moment, we're feeling that we're going to do something which is going down in history. So the Navy is really training us so that we can stand out in each of our operations. So we feel that from our side, we have to give it our best, because tomorrow when we go on that helicopter or we go on that ship, the operation will always remain the same how it has been earlier. So we have to bring ourselves up to that bar. And the feeling is just, you know, give it all you've got, give it your best.
Do you feel, Riti and Kumudini, that there's a lot of scrutiny on you because, you know, you are the first, you're the women making history, as they say, right? So how would you feel in terms of the pressure that is on you?
Pressure is there. A sense of responsibility is a word which I can use right now, because whatever we'll do in the training phase will actually will be the landmark ki whether the youngsters, the other women officers will be joining the same platform based on our performance in the helicopter stream. So therefore, our pressure and our sense of responsibility is there.
And how would you say other women can derive inspiration from this moment? Kumudini, I'll start with you. You know, because the point is that one thing that women have really been fighting for, and as someone who's been reporting to the military for decades now, I've been wanting women to be allowed more and more into combat roles. So do you see this, Kumudini, as a first step? Because you are the first, even the Navy's own statement says, these are the first women airborne combatants, right? So we are moving towards women in combat. We now have women fighter jet pilots in the Air Force. We have a woman who's going to be flying the Rafale. And you are now on warships, on destroyers, on frigates. You're going to be flying multi-role helicopters. So first tell us a little bit about the helicopters that you're training on, because not everybody is as well versed with military matters as both of you are.
So first of all, we are not the first who are the observers. We are the first observer airborne tactician who will be operating from the helicopters. Since 2009, the Navy has inducted women officers as the observer. The first batch was in 2009. So We are not the first one. We are the first one who will be operating from the helicopters. And these helicopters are the one who are the ship-borne helicopters. Means they take off from the ship. And if you see in a situation like a ship is always moving. If it is moving, then it is taking off from the ship. And then it, when it is landing, the ship is not at that place because it is moving. So task itself becomes challenging because now it has to land on a moving platform.
Yeah. So, but when you say you're not the first ones, my understanding is that till this time, while women definitely were in logistics and planning, Navy's own statement said that the takeoffs and landings used to happen ashore, not on the warships per se, right? That is the big change, that women were not on board on warships. So this moment, because warships is a combat role, right? You're the, that's what I meant by the first ever such moment. So Riti, do you see it like that?
So what we were trying to say is that we're not the first observers in the Indian Navy.
Yes, yes, of course, of course. Yeah, but I meant the first vis-a-vis the warships.
Definitely, we are the first two women officers who will be deployed on board helicopters. Helicopters have that specialty that they can board warships and even the smaller ships of the Indian Navy. And yes, definitely what we are doing, we are the first who will be doing this. And after this, you should hopefully see a lot of us. And we don't have any much apprehensions regarding the same because even though you said that, you know, there will be a lot of scrutiny, but because of that, I think that has pumped us up even more that we have to give it our best shot and do everything that we can now that we've come here and the Navy has given this chance to us. I don't think we are going to leave anything, any stone unturned. So there'll be nothing left to doubt for anybody.
Wonderful. Now, I want to ask both of you, do you feel that women should be let fully into combat roles? Because no woman I have interviewed over the years has said no to that answer. Like most women say, we are ready. Give us a chance and we'll prove ourselves. So do you feel like that also?
Yes, definitely. We are ready. And Navy is giving opportunities. Doors are now open. So yes, of course, why not?
Riti?
I'd like to say that we are sub-lieutenants now, that so most of the decisions and things like that are not in our hands. Whatever the Navy tells us to do, we go ahead and do it. But the kind of role we are going in, I think it's quite an ultimate role. So there is not much left for, you know, that women aren't doing in the Navy, given that now we are going on ships. So the Navy has by and large opened everything for women to do now. So no, there is nothing left now that we can say that, you know, we are not in this stream or not in that stream. By and large, Navy has taken women into every stream that they can.
So I want to tell you a little story about myself. When you were not even born in 1999, when I went to report on the Kargil war from the front line, one of the reasons the military initially said no is they told me that aurton ke liye bathroom nahi hai. We don't have gender specific bathrooms. We don't have a place for you to sleep. And I said, that's fine. I'll figure it out. I'll go just like the guys do under a tree behind a rock. And I went. Now, for a long time, we used to hear about many roles in the military, many spaces in the military, including warships. Small things like this, little logistical things like no one had thought of having bathrooms for women. Of course, the Navy is going to change all of that. Do you think that these small things can become big giant barriers? You know, ye choti choti jo baatein hoti hai kyunki kisi ne socha hi nahi bahut sa.
Yes, of course. But for the Navy specific, I can say that the new warship which are now inducting. They have proper, they have suitable arrangements for the women officers. Moreover, the bigger ship, which are in service right now, they also have these facilities. So we can't say that the facilities are not there. But in case, though it is not like that, if it would not have been there, we are soldier first. So we could have adjusted in any of the situation we'll be facing in life.
Elaborate on that point that you just said, that we are soldiers first. I love that line. And I think most women do not want to be seen through the gender lens. You want to be evaluated not as women naval aviators. You want to be evaluated as naval aviators. You want to be judged on the merit of your work, right? So talk a little bit, Sub-Lieutenant Riti, about that line you just said, we are soldiers first. Because being a soldier in the end is gender neutral and has to be.
I think the best part about the Indian Armed Forces and maybe now that we're speaking about the Navy is that everybody here, let's say in Southern Naval Command, we're all roaming around in white. We're all at par. We are only judged by the kind of work we do. Nothing else is criteria over here. Maybe the story that you're sharing is of 1999, 20
years ago. Yes, it's long back. It's long back.
A lot has changed. Maybe you should come down and visit Southern Naval Command. You will see that there is everything for everybody here now. And like we said, not many people may be aware, but now the Navy is changing. The ships that are coming now, they are all equipped for women to be taken on board. In fact, we are right now undergoing a small course, after which Sub-Lieutenant Kumudni, along with two other of our course mates, will be going on mostly on a one-month ship attachment. So the Navy has really opened up all its doors. So those stories that, you know, there's no washroom for women or anything like that is history now.
It's wonderful for me to hear that. And of course, the story I'm telling is from 21 years ago. And definitely, I'm going to come down and see all of you in action. Nothing pleases me more. I want to know a little bit about both of you personally, how you came into the Navy, what your backgrounds are, when you knew you wanted to fly, when the uniform was, you know, something that you dreamt of. So I'll start with you, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini. Tell me about yourself. Tell our viewers about you.
I have done my B.Tech in Computer Science Engineering. I belong to a very civil background. My father runs a security agency in Ghaziabad. So that time I was not aware what armed forces are when I was in my school times. So later with time I realized in 2015 when Lieutenant Kiran Shikhawat, she was also observer in Indian Navy, she got martyred. So that incident actually pinched me that I should also do something good for the country. So that time I started watching videos of Navy, asking my friends who were in the defense forces how was the life. So they always talked about the good things. That time I was not aware that about the Ragada and other sessions. But when I went to the Indian Naval Academy, I did the training. So that moment created a brotherhood amongst each other because we both know each other since our SSB. Service Selection, we got recommended together. Then we were in the same stream in our Indian Naval Academy. We have joined the same stream and now we are in the same helicopters. So the experience was good.
So you're saying you don't actually come from a military background at all. You just read about a woman icon who martyred, who sacrificed her life in the line of duty, and you were inspired. Is that right, Kumudini?
Yes, it is right.
And Sub-Lieutenant Riti, what's your story?
Our stories are very different. So unlike her, I come from a totally 4G background. So I'm fourth generation 4G. So my grandfather is ex-NDA, my dad was also in the Navy. So since a very young age, I have seen men in the uniform around me. And they are the major reason that I was inspired from a very young age, looking at them, looking at how determined they are towards their work, looking at their lifestyle, looking at the kind of knowledge they have about what they're doing. I had this goal set really early in life that, you know, this is where I want to be. This is the uniform that I have to don in days to come.
And I want to ask both of you, how did your families and larger families and immediate family react? Did you have trouble convincing them? Now, I imagine because Riti came from a 4G family, it was easier. Was it tougher for you, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini?
Yeah, definitely it was tough because in North India, most of the people, they are not aware what Indian Navy is doing. For them, Indian Navy and Merchant Navy is almost same. They don't know the difference between both of them. So making family understand, to make them realize that they both are different things and I am going to Indian Armed Forces. So,
How did they react? How did they react? Like what were some of the silly things, Kumudini, that you had to hear? Because you didn't come from a 4G culture. Civilians oftentimes don't know anything about the forge, right? Despite, except for what they see in the news and what they see in cinema, unko idea hi nahi hai. So what were some of the silly things that you had to counter, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini?
So when I told my father that I want to join the Indian Armed Forces, so my father, obviously parents always take care of the children, so they were more concerned about my safety. So they told me that ab tu pani pe rahegi kya hamesha. So horizon is very narrow in the Navy. They don't know, actually don't, they are not aware that Navy has a greater horizon where it serves from the land, water and sea. So there are much more to it, you know. Then I made them realize. So after that, my parents have always been supportive to whatever I'm saying. They actually listened to me, what I was saying. So they were agreed. So after that, I had given the service selection board. I got recommended from Bangalore. And the journey was not just smooth, but yes, we have overcome all our hurdles. But there are many more to go.
What are the hurdles that you see going forward? Because, you know, hurdles are there in any person's life, but a military soldier's life much more. And you're combining two specialized skills, one of flying and two of combat roles, right? So whether it's being deployed from destroyers or frigates, whether it's being on recce missions or surveillance missions, you're going to be doing all of it. You're going to be training for all of it. So without giving away anything sensitive, how tough is the training? Like, how many hours a day do you have to train? I'll start with you, Sub-Lieutenant Riti.
The training that we've already done, we've done on a fixed wing aircraft. So both of us have already completed a minimum of 60 hours of flying before we donned this badge. We are already, so like you can see in the training phase itself, the Navy has made us airborne for more than 60 hours. Now we're going to specifically train on our helicopter. That training is going to again happen for about 9 to 10 months. So the hurdles are going to be operational specific only. But for that, those hurdles, the Navy is going to train us enough. The Navy has a lot of equipments, a lot of, in Southern Naval Command, a lot of training goes on in this under-training phase. So I think whatever hurdles we will face, we will be able to overcome them because of the kind of effort that we will be putting in the next few months.
What has been the toughest thing for both of you to get to this dream point? I know both of you are living your dream right now, right? I can see the excitement in your eyes, like your eyes have just lit up with that joy. And I'm jealous of you. I wish I was still in my 20s and I could fly a helicopter. But what has been the toughest thing to get to this point? Kumudini, I'll start with you, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini. Sabse mushkil cheez yahan tak aane ke liye. Aur main do sawal Hindi mein bhi puchungi, kyunki hamare bahut se darshak hain jo chote shehron mein hai, जो गांव में है, जो शायद हिंदी में भी आपको सुनना चाहे, तो मैं हिंदी में आपसे पूछूंगी, सबसे मुश्किल बात क्या या हर्डल क्या हुआ है यहां तक पहुंचने के लिए? आपसे शुरू करूंगी कुमुदिनी।
सबसे बड़ा हर्डल जो मुझे लगा, हर्डल इट वाज अ चैलेंज क्लियर द सर्विस सिलेक्शन बोर्ड, टू बी वेरी फ्रैंक।
अच्छा,
यस, टू दैट बिकॉज़ आई गॉट रिकमेंडेड इन माय थर्ड अटेम्प्ट।
ओके, बट यू डिडंट गिव अप। आपने गिव अप नहीं किया, लेकिन आप ट्राई करती गई।
एवरी टाइम व्हेन आई गॉट कॉन्फ्रेंस आउट, सो आई ऑलवेज, मेरे दिमाग में सिर्फ एक ही चीज थी दैट आई एम नियरर टू माय गोल। आई हैव नेवर थॉट कि आई एम फार, आई ऑलवेज थिंक नाउ आई एम नियरर टू माय गोल। सो व्हेन आई वेंट फॉर द थर्ड एसएसबी, बिफोर गिविंग दिस एसएसबी, दैट सेल्फ, मतलब दैट ऑप्टिमिज्म वाज देयर दैट दिस टाइम आई एम गोना डू इट। सो दैट वाज एक्चुअली ट्रू, दैट केम ट्रू। So that I find that it was the biggest challenge because it is the first step to come into the Indian Armed Forces.
Fantastic. And Riti, aapke liye sabse mushkil baat yahan tak pahunchne ke liye?
I think sabse mushkil baat yahi hogi ki humne bahar se computer science mein graduation kiya tha and then humne observer branch ke liye apply kiya. So from graduates to turn into aviators, it takes a lot of effort. Bahut mehnat jaati hai us cheez mein. बहुत पढ़ना पड़ता है। एक बार उस एयरक्राफ्ट में 3-4 घंटे बैठने के लिए, उससे पहले हमें 8-10 घंटे मेहनत करनी पड़ती है टू सिट इन दैट एयरक्राफ्ट फॉर 2-3 आवर्स। सो दैट वाज अ हर्डल, दैट वाज अ हर्डल इनिशियली बिकॉज दैट टाइम वी वर स्टिल लर्निंग। नाउ वी इवेंचुअली, यू स्टार्ट फाइंडिंग दैट यू नो अ लिटिल इजियर। वन हर्डल इज टू बिकम अ एविएटर इन द इंडियन आर्म फोर्सेज बिकॉज देयर इज नो स्कोप ऑफ एरर। So training is brutal and not easy to clear. But we cleared our first step. So we are hoping that, you know, with our constant effort, we'll scrape through it all.
Okay, I have just a couple of minutes left. So I want to ask you two things. पहले मैं आपसे दोनों से पूछूंगी। You know, sometimes our biology as women is used against us. So you must have seen, you know, young girls are today arguing about period leave, which I am totally against. Sometimes the fact that women can be parents is used against us. So as young women who are in the military in a very frontline role, you're going to be in a very frontline role, when your biology is sometimes used by people who don't know better, bahar jaise aap logo se milte hain, ki shaadiyon pe jaate hain, rishtedar hote hain, when biology is used as a barrier, what would you say to that? Because that has been a barrier that has been used against us as women over decades. Riti, I'll start with you.
In the armed forces, there's only one barrier. Barrier is only mission specific. Nothing else is a barrier. Our biological system is a part of our system and it is treated like that. If ever we have for a moment or two any requirement, We are quite open about it. There is no stigma attached to it in the Indian Armed Forces. We are a very open society. And the only barrier or the only, wall that needs to be broken down is all in operational terms. Rest, everything women have been handling since a lot of years. We're not the first women in the Indian Armed Forces. We are the first only going on board the helicopter. But like I said, there is, till date, we have never faced, we've spent almost 2 years here now. Nobody has ever questioned us about, that you're using something as an excuse. We have never used anything also as an excuse.
Absolutely.
That we, from our sides, never give anybody an opportunity to speak anything on those terms.
I completely relate to what you've just said. Sub-Lieutenant Kumutini, if you'd like to add to that.
Yes, it is a natural process, first of all. And people is accepting all these things. In the Indian Armed Forces, all these things are very open. So in the training phase also, in the Indian Naval Academy, we have physical training. That time, we have never used it as somewhat we can call it an excuse. Our body is something which is very adaptive, you know. When you have period and you start running, your body gets used to it. It is nothing like you cannot run. You cannot walk. You cannot stand. It is nothing like that. It is just an adaptive process, and it sometimes it takes time, but it is natural.
I fully agree, and I hope people who are preventing women from going forward using a kind of biological fatalism are paying close attention to you. Final question, there are many young girls. Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini, you were able to be a woman in uniform because another woman inspired you. I want both of you to now inspire other young girls who are facing all kinds of barriers. So your final message for young girls watching you everywhere, I'll start with you, Kumudini, and then Preeti.
Yes, like I belong to a civilian background. For me, I don't know anything about Indian Armed Forces in my school time. So with due course of time, I have learned through newspaper, through YouTube channels, watching your videos also, ma'am. So I can do it, then anybody can do it. It is just a determination which is required. If you fail in the service section board once, it does not mean the life is over. It is, you should always think that you're closer and closer and closer.
Fantastic. Riti?
I just like to tell everybody out there who has any apprehension about the armed forces or about women in the armed forces, we have a lovely system over here which is very supportive in nature. Everybody is treated equally out here, and we are living examples of that. So anyone who wants to join the Indian Navy, there's a beautiful website which we ourselves were used to spend a lot of time on when we were applying. So any girl or any boy out there who wants to do something different with their life and wants an exciting life, not everybody gets the chance of having their office space in a helicopter. So anyone who wants to do something exciting, you would definitely have to join the Indian Navy.
One thing is there's no work from home when you're flying helicopters, right? Yeah. So, but more seriously, you know, when I was young, there was such a romance around men in uniform, and we all used to say, wow, a man in uniform is something else. But as I've grown older, I just want to say that nothing excites me more than seeing women in uniform. And therefore, before I say goodbye to you, I just want to play all these pictures again, just one last time. It makes me so proud to see where women have come. And also salutes to our military. You know, I do want to say salutes to our military, because they're really leading the way in breaking down these barriers. All the best to you, Sub-Lieutenant Kumudini and Sub-Lieutenant Riti. You make us proud. I hope you inspire young girls everywhere that if you dream, anything at all is possible. That's one more barrier down, and you will lead the way, I know, in bringing many more barriers down. All the best, and God bless you. Thank you.